Welcome to everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today and to talk about a specific topic that we enjoy at Circle. First of all, I will talk about something that we have to do as a CSIRT. And the thing that I'm talking about today will be about scanning, internet-wide scanning, and the different things that as a CSIRT we have to do, but we are facing some challenges. And one of the first challenges, and if you are operating a CSIRT, when you have to scan for or find specific vulnerabilities in your infrastructures or in your constituents, you usually rely on scanning from third parties. And sometimes it's difficult for you to find out, okay, at which level the scan is. Do we have the latest data of the scan and so on? So it's one of the issues, one of the most common issues, I mean, for the CSIRT. Another issue that we have as a CSIRT is sometimes the scanning is incomplete or at least localized in a different country, even if you have, for example, services in your constituency. So it's very common for scanning services, for example, to wrongly assign the locations of the scanning network and so on. Another thing is if you want to quickly find out new vulnerable machines, new vulnerable devices, in your infrastructure or the constituent country or and stuff like that, it's becoming more and more difficult because you have to find and to do the complete IPv4 address space scanning. So it might take time and so on. So those kind of things becoming more and more difficult. Another thing that is really difficult too is a lot of scanning, for example, is based on IP addresses. But nowadays, a lot of services are based on name. So that means so when you do a scanning on an IP address, you are missing a lot of services or potential vulnerable device too. Because for example, on TLS, you have SNI, meaning that you have name-based services. So you need to scan with those names and not with the IP addresses to discover those ones. Another thing that is tough is to discover really active and newly exposed devices that you cannot find quickly if you do kind of exhaustive search on all the IPv4 space, or you cannot even find the IPv6 space. So today, what I want to do with you is really to discuss strategies on how to improve that. And really, the thing that I want to show to you is basically to summarize the technique that we discovered, that we tested, we tried at Circle, and that we are nowadays using to find all those vulnerable machines. I will mention some of the techniques, their advantages, disadvantages, because you know not everything is coming with like perfect solutions, but sometimes you have to find the right balance between finding quickly devices and, for example, having less resources to be used when doing the scanning and so on. So obviously, the technique I will mention today are not an exhaustive list of all the techniques available, but I will cover the most, I would say, applicable strategies for a CSIRT, without going into complex or at least pretty large solutions. So to give you a quick overview of what we will discuss is the different techniques that we will show today are basically different ones. So it's not a single one, and you will see that those different techniques are interlinked between each other. So I will talk about certificate transparency, which is a source or data source of information that you can use for finding vulnerable machines. I will talk about, for example, passive DNS data stream and specific techniques that you can, or even trick that you can use to find out that. You'll see that some of the tricks that we are using to find out and scan some new networks and so on are always going back to specific techniques. And on this diagram and the site are available and are shared with everyone, you'll see that, for example, one of the techniques, which is basically the brute forcing of DNS records and so on, is a recursive technique that is used in all the different places. So usually what you will see for scanning, it's a combination of all those different techniques together to find out vulnerable devices, new IPv6 ranges, new IPv6 addresses, and so on, by using those different techniques. So the first one I want to talk to you, and I think this one is maybe familiar for you, it's the certificate transparency. So the majority of certificate authorities nowadays are publishing a kind of logbook, and this logbook contains a continuous stream of all the logs from the certificate being signed and so on, which is a very interesting source of information. A lot of people, for example, are using that for discovering phishing, a new set of websites of phishing, and so on. In our case here, we will use it as a source of information to potentially scan new and discover new services to be scanned. First, and I think this one is quite important, when you get access to the certificate transparency list, you have different open source tools where you can basically get such kind of information. You have even public accessible services for the logbooks. Thing that you have to do is basically to extract the 509 certificate. So those certificates are published in their format in the certificate transparency. And what we are doing for finding new services and to, for example, feed our scanning mechanism, we are extracting all the subject name from the certificate. So it means that all the records that are used for the certificate. And what we do, we basically brute force and we resolve all the records. So the A records, the quadruple A records to find the IPv6 associated addresses and the IPv4 address associated to those subject names. For each of the host names, so we do that. What we do too is automatically when we record and get that record, we have this IP address, we store it in a kind of Elastin database. So for us, it's I think quite efficient because a lot of recurring lookup is giving the same IP address. So you don't want to scan again the same IP address. So you have to differentiate IP addresses that are newly discovered from the one that has already been seen. So we have a kind of quick lookup on that. If you're interested on how we are doing it, even the script that we use for doing that is part of one of our projects. It's called City Scrutinize, where we have a City DNS Resolver Python script, which is basically doing the resolving of those things. And then we feed those new IP addresses to the scanner, and the scanner will scan. There are some drawbacks to this solution, and that's something to keep in mind. When you do such kind of things, when you have a certificate transparency issue, so when you have your certificate issue, it doesn't mean that the final services is already set up and running on the remote host. So you have to keep that in mind for your scanner activities. So that means you have to keep back those kind of IP addresses for a specific period of time and retry multiple times sometimes to access. So what you have seen is usually in a period of like 48 hours, 72 hours, you might have different services popping up on the machines after certification has been set up, which makes sense because system administrators usually set up a cell certificate and then later on they give to a third parties, another organization, another team, someone that is doing the setup, and they are providing this kind of things. So you see that the certificate transparency is one of the interesting sources of information for your scanner, so you can really brute force all the A and quadruple A records to get IPv4 and IPv6 address space to scan and find quickly potential vulnerable machines on the internet. Another thing that is interesting too is when you extract those kind of hostname and domain resolution that you have from certificate transparency, you might do an additional step. And this one is a step that is done very often in finding actively new hosts and so on, is to basically brute force the hostname. So how does it work? It's very straightforward. So we will append to a specific domain name, specific hostname, and some additional hostname that could be resolvable. So for doing that, you have different strategies. I mean, for what we do on our site, very simple. We have kind of top 20 hostname that we use. For example, WW is one, mail, server, and others are used. And then you can automatically find out additional machines that are maybe on the same domain and so on. Be very careful because the brute force activities, when you are brute forcing DNS, it can be slow. So if you enumerate, for example, a complete dictionary, which is pretty large, it might take a lot of time. So usually you have to find the right balance between the brute forcing of the DNS versus the time that you have to have the answer. So what we do usually for having a very quick resolution is to have a top 20. So we have a top 20 of domain names with those kind of additional hosts that we append to the domain names. And those ones are the most commonly used that we have seen, for example, in the passive DNS. We might have a regional one because in some countries you might have, for example, server express in French, for example, or server express in English, for example, in different countries. So depending on the country you are in, you might have a different way of doing that. But sometimes you want to go a bit further. So you want to brute force much more hosts, but you still want to have a kind of efficient space for that. So some years ago, we did work with another university on that, and we have an advanced technique called DNS brute forcer, which is SDBF, and we're using Markov chain models for that and to recover additional hostnames. So it's one strategy. Again, this kind of brute forcing of hostname is really a key element in your chain of discovering potential new IP addresses and so on, because you have sometimes just a new domain and you have to brute force the associated hostname for that specific domain. So that's one common way of doing it. So the thing is, when you find specific IPv6 addresses, you get an additional information. So if you know that a specific IPv6 address is used, it means that the IPv6 associated subnet is active, because this one is routable, accessible to third parties, and so on. So what you can do there, you can get an additional brute forcing on the IPv6 address, because the IPv6 space is pretty large. But if you end up with having just a subnet that you know that is already used, because you get an IP address in that subnet, you can do what we call brute forcing of the IPv6 manual allocations. So it means that you will use some specific trick to discover those IPv6 addresses. One of the most commonly tricks is to use compressed IPv6 address, because when addresses are pretty large, it's difficult to remember those, but a lot of operators are setting up routers, infrastructures, backend infrastructures on very compressed IPv6 address. So that means if you get a subnet, just write the first entries on those kind of subnet, and you will get some response. So usually it's like even between 10 or 20%, so it's quite important. Additional one is if you have manual allocations, usually it's a human setting up the allocation. So that means they are using a specific X block, for example, hexadecimal block that they can remember. And it's not uncommon to see, for example, blocks like DET, BEEF, ABBA, CAFE, quadruple F, and stuff like that. Because those ones are easy to remember, and you have, for example, subnet where you have like that four times in the hexadecimal representation of the address. So you can just brute force that to discover additional IP addresses. Another thing that we have seen, and this one is pretty common, some of the final part of the IPv6 address contains the service itself. So that means the TCP or UDP port associated to the specific services. So it's a very easy way to brute force manual allocation. Nevertheless, manual allocation is just a part of the IPv6 address space. And the thing is, you have a lot of randomized IPv6 address, which is a thing quite nice, because it means that it's difficult to track down user and so on. But for scanning, it's becoming difficult too. On the screen that you can see now, it's a result of just an extraction of the IPv6 addresses I've seen on the Circle LU website. And it's just to give you an idea of how many IPv6 are randomized nowadays. And you see that around 85% of the IPv6 addresses reaching out the Circle LU website on one day are randomized. So it's quite a significant number. So it's not like a small percentage. So that means a lot of those IPv6 addresses are randomized. So meaning that if you want to scan those, good luck. It's much more difficult. Nevertheless, you can see that you still have some lower percentage of IPv6 addresses there, which are what we call low bytes. Things like, for example, crawlers and things like that are using those kind of non-randomized IPv6 addresses because they are manually allocated. So that means those ones are easy to scan or discover. So it's, again, a nice data set to discover which one you need to scan. Nevertheless, there's something interesting here. I was using basically the lock entries of my web server to find out those randomized IPv6 addresses. So it might give an idea then for you. It might give an idea on how to collect those randomized IPv6 addresses. If you have a public web services, it's a nice way to basically get all those IPv6 addresses to scan. And that's another trick that you can do. Some security operators are running public services. Web services, even network services, for example, DNS, NTP services, STUN, whatever. And they are using that as a source of scanning. So it's not uncommon sometimes when you reach out to public services, you are scanned back. And that's one of the effects. So it's another way to find out new IPv6 addresses that you can use for scanning, new one that has been set up. There's another trick, for example, and some are doing that. They are using BitTorrent trackers. So as you know, how does it work for BitTorrent? When you are a BitTorrent client, you need to connect to a tracker to basically say to the swarm of client that you have such kind of blocks there. But in the BitTorrent protocol, you have what we call the get peers request. So that means if you connect to a specific torrent that are in a tracker, you can ask for all the IPv6 addresses that you get. So you have this what we call N6 request. So it was introduced some years ago, but it's giving all back to all the IPv6 addresses. So it's another way to scan IPv6 addresses because those are active, functional, and are even used to see the torrent currently. So it's one way of getting information. And you see that such kind of things is, I think, easy to set up. There's no big deal with that one. And if you want to have a source of randomized IPv6 addresses, it's one way to do it. If you're interested in the topic of the BitTorrent tracker, there's a very good paper on the university in UK. And this thesis is about analysis of Bantu attacks in BitTorrent Swarm. It's giving a lot of details about the protocol and so on, and you see that there are a lot of opportunities there to collect information. Another thing that is interesting too for bootstrapping a scan and to have really a regional scan is to start with a complete dump of the reverse PTR of the IPv4 space. So as you know, IPv4 is 2^32. So that means you can enumerate all the IP addresses, but you can enumerate the reverse entry in the DNS for all those IP addresses. And if you do that, then it's very interesting because you can find out a lot of associated domain names for an IP address in specific namespace or CIDR block, which are, for example, allocated in other countries. So it's one way to find out if, for example, some IPv4 addresses that are located, for example, in US should be, for example, located in Russia, and you have a block of IP addresses where you have, for example, .ru domain there. So it's one way to at least, for example, when you do scan, to make more regional scan based on reverse PTR address. So that it's one way to do that. Additionally, it's again a nice source of information to bootstrap your DNS brute forcer to extract the domain names and so on. And again, to do the same job than before, like the city log that you were analyzing before, to extract all those IPv6 addresses and IPv4 addresses, and again to scan those and feed those to your scanner. So the IPv4 reverse space is very interesting. It's giving a lot of insight there about the reallocation sometimes of some subnet, even if the width entry, for example, from the regional registry is incorrect. Another thing that is, I think, quite interesting and nowadays that we are doing quite a lot of people are deploying services on GitHub, for example, and other services too, not only GitHub, but GitLab and some others. And many of those provide a public stream of all of the projects that have been committed and so on. So it's giving you a real gold mine of potential of spend there, because you basically have the commits, you have the source code, and a lot of organizations, for example, are testing in pre-production on GitHub, pushing code, and then you end up with having hostname there. So you can find there potential vulnerable devices, misconfigured devices, and things like that. So, I mean, if you are a defender, it's very good to do it, because at the end, attackers are doing it too. We have seen that we did some tests where we were pushing information into GitHub and so on, and some hostname were scanned by a third party. So in any case, it's good to do it. And for doing that, we have a small library that I developed some years ago called Domain Classifier. This one is really simple, but it's I think, one way to divide and conquer such kind of data is automatically extracting all the potential hostname and generating IPv6, doing DNS lookup and so on. And then you can find out the real hostname and the associated IPv6 addresses and so on. So it's one way, it's a very good source, and you can do that with any unstructured data sources, I mean, social networks, forum, and so on. And it's a one way, it's another way to scan not a complete space that you want to find vulnerable machine, but just only looking at hostname that are been recently published in GitHub, for example. Another thing, and it's quite interesting too, there are some providers providing what they call the newly registered domain list. So it's list of all those new domains that have been registered. Some are accessible through ICANN, so they have a program called CZDES, which is providing an access. You can register, ask for entries, and you will get the entries of specific TLD. Not all of them. So, I mean, for example, some country specific TLD are not providing such kind of stream, which is, for example, the case in Luxembourg, but so it's sometimes difficult to get that. If you purchase a feed from some vendors, it's existing, but it can be very costly. Another strategy there is to use passive DNS stream, because passive DNS contains newly registered domains indirectly because people start to query those. And in addition to that, you have already IPv4 and IPv6 addresses associated to the record, which is giving a very nice source for scanning and so on. So that's another way of finding the active scanning. Another way to do it is to look at the BGP monitoring aspect. So when you need to scan, sometimes you basically scan the whole internet, but it's not so efficient. Sometimes you just want to scan, for example, things that are very recent, which are unstable because some unstable networks are in currently setup mode and stuff like that, because you can prioritize the scanning on networks that have the highest probability of having vulnerable machines and so on that you can notify. So monitoring BGP message is very interesting. You can find new CIDR block announced in IPv6 and IPv4, so that's quite interesting. You don't need to have a complete BGP setup for doing that. RIPE is providing a very nice feature called the Routing Information Service Live feed, which is like a complete feed of all their BGP sensors they have around the world, and you get all the messages coming there. So it's a really nice source, and this one has a lot of potential for finding out new networks and so on, especially in stable one and so on. It's a very good source for doing that such kind of thing. In addition to what we do and what we did for some past year, it's analyzing the network telescope aspect. So if you have a network telescope, you have a gathering unsolicited network traffic, and you can analyze everything that you get out of that. For example, sometimes you get DNS requests that are interesting to, again, do scanning back, things like that. You can even do IPv6 extractions out of some GRE packet that are sent in IPv4, so it's sometimes giving some interesting things. Another thing that is interesting too, if you see, for example, some specific source IP addresses ending in your black hole, like, for example, scanning SSH, scanning RDP, and things like that, it's already giving a huge insight to you that, okay, those source IP addresses are very interesting. So you can use those lists as a kind of priority mechanism for scanning. So instead of scanning, again, sequentially, you can reorder your scan based on the different sources that you see on your black hole. The only drawback for this solution, and we have seen that for the past year, the volume of newly IPv6 addresses seen and so on is very low. So it's an interesting source. You might find very interesting host, but it's not a constant stream like the certificate transparency where you see a lot of entries popping up and so on. So that's basically it for me for the introduction of the active scanning techniques. The goal of the presentation of today is really to bootstrap a kind of GitHub account where we will list all the techniques that we know about for the active scanning. As I said, not exhaustive there, so maybe some of the techniques are missing, some techniques are maybe not really applicable for you and so on. So don't hesitate to go to the GitHub repository. We'll add some markdown document there with the different things. The slides are available there and some additional references. So if you have any question and answer, I will be more than happy to answer you today. Thank you.